let's just bring that noise right down. Although we live in a time of rage, right? Or anxiety, or uncertainty, or all of the above. The COVID crisis, lockdowns, vaccinations, them and us. Conspiracy theories, radicalization, hate. Now, the worst of it is coming from a very small minority of us, but there's no doubt that angry outbursts against people who are not in any kind of position of power are becoming more common. Everyone has a right to protest, full stop. But what's driving some of us to rage? Who's radicalizing us? How do you cope if you're on the receiving end of this? What do you do if you are feeling that kind of anger or anxiety? What can we do to disagree but still treat each other with respect? We're going to look at all of that tonight, and we also, we hope, are going to offer a glimmer of hope from people who have seen us at our best. But we're going to begin with people who see us at our angriest every single day. Frontline workers, supermarket workers, first responders who have seen us and heard us and experienced us at our worst. And a warning, our hate expresses itself in ugly ways. But if you're offended hearing this language, imagine how it would feel if it was directed at you.
Over the last 18 months, I feel like Kiwis have forgotten how to treat each other. We've been called names.
Murderer, a poisoner.
A fucking bitch, a slut.
Blackie, fob, effing seas, effing pig.
Scum. A bitch, a whore.
Curry muncher.
You're from India, how can you tell us what to do?
Coconut, go back home to where you come from.
Go back to your country.
Go back home.
And when we hear that kind of abuse, something inside you sort of eats away at you. And you sort of start questioning yourself.
How can they say something like that when they don't even know who I am?
Kia ora, my name is Jackie. I work in a vaccination clinic.
My name's Olive.
My name is Mark.
Kia ora, I'm Talisha.
I'm Vitali. So I was actually born in New Zealand.
I'm a second generation Kiwi.
I'm a daughter, I'm a granddaughter, I'm a niece, I'm a cousin, and I do want to be treated with respect.
It's been a long time in lockdown.
Working through a pandemic is difficult in itself.
Anxiety of lockdown has increased.
People are not tolerating each other.
Now everyone's just angry.
We were threatened to be run off the road.
Was threatened to have my car vandalised while I was still in it.
It would get bottles thrown at us.
Multiple times we were punched, kicked, scratched.
Intimidating photos taken of them and a road bike thrown at someone.
One of the guys just trying to punch on my face.
Me and my staff have been spat on, we've been bitten.
I was bitten on my leg 2 times. I've had people spit in my face.
Some of my workers have actually been stabbed.
My name's Jolie and I'm site lead for a vaccination clinic.
My name's Tom.
My name is Jasbir Singh.
My name is Gabby.
Hi, I'm Warwick.
Hi, I'm Councillor Josephine Bartley.
It's really scary and quite horrifying.
You definitely got to think about it all the time, that something's going to happen to you.
And it affects the jobs that we go to, we lose trust in people.
It makes me feel anxious that I have to deal with it.
I feel worried for my own safety when I'm out there in the community.
It's very disheartening to come to work and be abused when I have got up in the morning and come to work to help people.
I'm exhausted and I'm tired. I know that everyone else is feeling like this too, but we're just trying to do our job and keep everyone safe.
We're just trying to do our job and keep our community safe.
Just doing our job.
We've got some team members in the store that have been working 6 to 7 days.
You've called us for help and we want to be there to help you.
You know, it's our job. We shouldn't be feeling like that.
We've got a responsibility to our own whānau who are anxious at home.
There's people that worry about me when I come to work.
I've got a little family and, you know, I want to go back, be able to go back to them.
I wish we could go back to where we were before COVID. We're a nation that stood up for each other. Now we seem to be a nation of individuals.
Sometimes it feels really sad because.
Why on earth would we speak to people like that? What's driving it? Is it fear? Is it helplessness? Is it the lack of a voice? We asked a clinical psychologist with pretty extraordinary experience, including with the UN on the International Criminal Court, and also fire and emergency and police, both here in New Zealand and in Australia. And I asked Reiner Bogdanovich why a pandemic would make us yell at a supermarket worker.
What we know about the current situation is that individuals are feeling really, you know, they're feeling hostile, they're feeling helpless. Individuals are feeling a lot of sadness at the moment, as well as, you know, grief for what we might have, you know, for what we might have lost. And a lot of these undercurrent of emotions are actually coming out as anger. We know that anger is what we call a secondary emotion, with other emotions being underneath that. And so when we're feeling those mix of emotions, they tend to come out as anger, and they're coming out a lot towards our first responders at the moment.
So if I'm up against it, if I'm a bit worried about whether or not my business is going to stay open, or I don't quite understand the traffic light system, or I'm really scared of someone I love getting COVID, why would I yell at a supermarket worker? Why would I call a supermarket worker some of the appalling things that we've heard them being called?
Yeah. This is a tricky question, and I think, honestly, a multifaceted one. What we know, though, is that when we struggle as humans to really cope with what's going on internally for us, if we're feeling this anger, but really it's helplessness or sadness or guilt or fear, and we don't have the mechanisms to be able to deal with that, we may engage in what we call in psychology projection. We may project some of those emotions or some of what's going on for us unto those individuals. And that might be a police officer, or it might be a supermarket worker. So sometimes we engage in this projection because we can't quite deal with what might be going on within us or inside us.
But why do we say the really awful things? And why do we say some of the words I've heard in the preparation for this program, people being called slut, black, bitch? You know, why does that become our projection?
Certainly something that we know about anger and stress is that when we experience a heightened level of emotion, and when we are in fight or flight, what our brain actually does, we kind of call it the red brain. What happens when we're in fight or flight is that our capacity to deal with situations actually sort of lessens, and we see red, you know, we move straight in this way, and we struggle to sort of see all of the answers or all of the ways of looking at something. You know, it takes a lot of calm for us to be able to open our, you know, view and be able to deal with the situation in a more authentic or rational way. And so if you think of someone who's stressed, who's feeling fearful, who's feeling angry or anxious, what they're likely to be doing is having a shortened, you know, sense of capacity to be able to deal with the situation. What we also know is that the frontal parts of the brain actually switch off when we're angry or when we're anxious. And so people aren't using the usual vocabulary or the usual way that they would react to something. And so they react in quite an immediate, you know, or unhealthy way. They actually engage in unhealthy ways of coping. And some of those are calling individuals names or whatever it might be.
So if you're watching this now and you're recognizing yourself, and I suspect all of us will be to a certain extent, because we've all been under the pump one way or another in the past year or two, what do you do to deploy your front brain or to sort of step back from your own anger and be better?
I'd really encourage people to gain a level of insight and awareness into what they can control. What really is within your control, and not just what's within your control, but what can you be optimistic about? What can you get excited about? Because there's a lot really that we can control, and it's in our view of the absence of that that we start to get distressed, angry, anxious. And so I'd really encourage people to think about what it is that you can control in this moment, in this hour, in this day, in this rest of the year, to be able to live in a meaningful, you know, and positive way.
Clinical psychologist Reiner Bogdanovich, we want you to be part of this discussion. We're live now on Facebook. Come and join us. Have your say. Tell us your experiences. And of course, we'll have heaps more on these issues on all our digital platforms and our website, onenews.co.nz.
A group of men
were just watching me. And then one of them said something like, you're all scum.
It is the anger, the aggression, the nastiness, and in fact, the violence that has been bestowed on people.
The stunning song, Wunihonga's finest, hip-hop collective, Sweat It, with a song about racism here in Aotearoa called Bunga. A reminder that while the anger we're experiencing is new for some of us, for others it's something they've lived with and still do. Lance Burdett is a former police negotiator, really skilled at dealing with people on the edge, people who may be a threat to themselves or to others. Now he's involved in training people in how to de-escalate such situations, and he says he's never been busier.
Regardless of the organisation, doesn't matter what sector, whether it's IT, whether it's the health industry, whether it's with government departments, are under pressure from people coming at them. It is the robust discussions they're having, I'm being polite here. It is the anger, the aggression, the nastiness, and in fact, the violence that is being bestowed on people. First responders is a great example. Now, doctors and nurses have always been there. They are the, in my opinion, the unsung heroes of what we're going through at the moment. And they are receiving at the front end lots of hostility, lots of violence even. And for me, that's unacceptable, right? So there's a line drawn. So you have to now start responding in a way that's different to what we've responded to in the previous. Previously responded in a way with, you will, you should. That no longer works. We're now focusing on the angry person rather than the patient. Mm. The reason humans have survived as a species is we look after each other. We've been community. And at the moment also, many people are feeling isolated, and that isolation is causing disconnection. And so we feel even more fearful, which the default is the anger when we fear.
And so we yell at the supermarket worker, we yell at the nurse, we yell at people who have no power whatsoever over us.
Right.
We get on our horn if the traffic doesn't move quickly enough out of the lights.
Because it's got to a stage where the brain has to release it some way. And if unfortunately at the time of release it happens to be something that we're frustrated with, that person's going to get it. It's not aimed at that person, right? It's aimed at the situation.
Except that person really feels it.
Unfortunately, the person just happens to be the one taking the brunt.
Josephine Bartley knows about taking the brunt. An Auckland city councillor, she has received so much abuse, even death threats. We went to meet her, and then she took us to meet people who understand the power of using their words for good.
At the end of October, this vaccination centre in the Auckland suburb of Panmure was vandalised. The woman on the right is Josephine Bartley, councillor for the Mangakiakia Pāmiki ward.
I came down to check on them, make sure they're okay. Then I was doing some work in my car, and like a group of men were just watching me. And then one of them said something like, you're all scum. And so I wound down my window and I was like, sorry, what was that? I couldn't hear you. And then the other one just said, oh, let's just vandalise your car then.
Three angry, aggressive men, one woman.
When they said you're all scum,
yeah,
what was the all they were referring to, do you think?
I have no idea. Like, I try not to think about it.
Councillor Bartley's been abused before, but this felt new and really different.
I actually felt worried for my safety.
It felt like she'd been reduced to something less than them.
Because when I engage with them, they didn't engage with me like I was a person. You know, even when I see the protests and I see all those hate signs, it's scary because it doesn't take much for them to jump from that kind of behaviour to actually hurting someone.
On a glorious day last week, Councillor Bartley took us to meet a vaccination team setting up in Panmure.
Six by something.
Oh, have you already organised someone to do it?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is the team from Manurewa Marae. And if they're going to persuade hesitant people to get vaccinated, they have to win their trust. And trust is a human equation.
So if I turn up at your marae and I'm hesitant and I'm confused and I'm maybe a little bit angry about being in a situation I have no control over, what would you say to me? How would you talk to me?
I say, kia ora, welcome to Manurewa Marae. Everything will be okay. Sit down and have a kōrero with our team and our nurse. Yeah.
At the marae, regardless of what colour, what race, where you're from, you're all treated as family. Once you walk onto the marae, you're treated as whānau.
And you know, usually at the end of it, you've found out who they are, who their whānau are, you've built a relationship and a connection. Next thing you know, they're getting vaccinated.
Like Cruz, a Black Power member who's now working with the marae to help persuade men like him, who don't really like being told what to do, to get their vaccinations. And with a sense of purpose comes something else, Cruz is out of lockdown.
You haven't been in jail for 2 years.
Yeah, I haven't been in jail for 2 years.
And you can tell me to mind my own business, but is that the longest time in your adult life?
In my whole life.
Since you were how
Since
old?
Since I was 17.
So, congratulations,
Thank
Cruz.
You, Thank you very
and
much.
And how does that feel?
Well, it feels awesome, eh? Like, I'm actually doing something good for our community instead of doing, you know, like...
Something bad for your
something
community.
Something bad for your community, yeah. You know? And
which means when someone asks Cruz's children what he's doing, they can answer with pride.
Not always, Dad, he's in jail, you know? So it's like, yeah, it's a bit, gonna make me a bit emotional, mate.
Back on Panmure's main drag, Jo Bartley remembers the men who abused her hatefully. And then, early the next morning, how she awoke sensing something unusual was happening outside.
Mealami security from South Auckland were parked outside my driveway.
They stayed for days, pro bono, until she felt safe. And from the hate came the stuff Jo Bartley wants us to know still makes her feel hopeful. Kindness.
So you have seen the best of us and the worst of us, right?
I have. And it's been through this vaccination. Yeah, absolutely, the best. And I love it. You know, even these emails that come to me, and then the guy signed, he's like, we just think you're doing awesome. We think you're so brave. Please keep going. Signed, 75-year-old white guy. It's just awesome. And I'm just like, oh, okay, thanks.
The internet enables people to find information that confirms their belief. It enables them to connect with people who agree with them. And so it sort of allows you to isolate yourself from people around you. It allows the spread of bad information. It also allows the spread of hatred.
So I'm upset. I'm so angry. That is not okay to threaten people when they're just trying to do their job.
We keep talking about anxiety, so let's explain what we mean when we use that word. It's complicated and it's particular. Your anxiety might be quite different from mine. But what we share is that we all get tested sometimes. It might be work, family, money, or maybe it's a super virus rampaging through the world. Anxiety seems a pretty normal response to that. Sometimes it makes us feel sad, or hurt, or even angry. They are variations of what we sometimes call anxiousness. That's normal too. In fact, it can even be helpful. But there are times that feeling stays past its welcome or becomes way too much to handle. There are times that feelings of stress refuse to go away and start to affect the way we think, the way we live, the way we interact. That could be anxiety disorder. And that's normal too. Normal and human. Anxiety disorders are one of the most common mental health conditions around. About a quarter of us in New Zealand will experience it at some points in our lives. A quarter. And there are ways to let go. Like any injury, recognizing and treating it are the first steps to managing and overcoming it, along with understanding you aren't alone. So anxiety is a really normal human experience, but it can also be all-consuming for some of us, especially as the world becomes an angrier, less certain place. Joining us now, Jenny Shaw, who's been looking at the global picture, because Jenny, we are not alone in dealing with rage and fury, right? But I guess the question is, where and when did this become more commonplace?
Yeah, displays of anger and frustrations are definitely on the rise. And the way we usually see this is through mass protests. For some historical context, the Vietnam War protests in the US during the late 60s, New Zealand's own anti-nuclear movement with some dramatic battles on the water in the 80s, the divisive Springbok tour, and the mass protests which led to the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989. But there is no doubt demonstrations have become more widespread and more frequent in recent times. Some prominent examples: the pro-democracy protests in Hong Kong throughout 2019 and 2020, unrest which grew and grew and was met by a state backlash from the Chinese government. The Black Lives Matter movement, which went from just a hashtag to a global phenomenon, sparked by the killing of George Floyd, who died when a white police officer kneeled on his neck for over 8 minutes. On the other side of the political spectrum, the Capitol insurrection in January, a mob of Donald Trump supporters storming the seat of the US government, spurred on by unfounded claims of voter fraud and conspiracy theories. While protest means different things to different people, the right to protest is an essential part of democracy. You've got to have your say. Whether in an open, democratic society or even a minority group in an authoritarian regime. But what happens when protest goes digital and demonstration is driven by misinformation? This is Marianne Elliott. She's an expert on the threats posed to democracy by the digital world. How does online engagement influence real-world outlook?
So the way that the algorithms work is that they're designed to keep us watching or keep us engaged. And it so happens that human brains stay more engaged if the information that's being put in front of them is just a little bit more interesting, a little bit alarming, a little bit shocking. That's more likely to keep us watching.
What do we have to be wary of when we're interacting with digital media?
The internet enables people to find information that confirms their belief, that enables them to connect with people who agree with them. When our views are consistently confirmed and we're taken by these algorithms and platforms down a pathway that increasingly narrows the scope of information that we're exposed to and narrows perhaps the range of people who we feel we can connect and engage with.
How does that cause division in society?
So you see people becoming isolated from their friends and family because their views are increasingly extreme or polarised from those people around them. You see people unable to have any kind of cohesive democratic conversation about really important issues often it also allows the spread of hatred and people who are sort of intentionally whipping up hate because there is very little in place to control that.
That's Marianne Elliott, who has researched the impact of digital media on democracy. The internet, so hard to escape in our daily lives and so tricky to navigate when it comes to what's actually true or not.
Yep, thanks, Jenny. Although the internet does give you a chance to have your say, and we would love you to be part of this discussion here tonight. What are your thoughts? We want to hear them. Join us online, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We've got more platforms than an English railway station, and you'll find lots more on our website, onenews.co.nz. Bring it on.
We're concerned about the mental health of our people on the land.
It's just a belief that we have to be doing something. And our community has really come on board. Not just a Māori community, a Pākehā community as well.
recognise the current challenges facing our communities are very significant, and many people are struggling in different ways.
Welcome back. One of the things Lance Burdett said to us is, if you don't want someone to yell at you, listen to them before they feel the need to. Now, what we learned about social divisions in the last part of the program suggests some people are just going to yell at you anyway, right? But are we good at listening? In this part of the program, we meet a new protest group and a veteran protester. The new protest group is Groundswell, and when we called and said, hey, we'd like to come and meet you, they were initially a bit suspicious, reluctant. It seemed like they didn't trust me, they didn't trust TVNZ, they didn't trust Auckland and Wellington media. Why? What's going on? What's that about? What did you think when I said I'd like to come down and meet you? Did you think, oh, here comes the bloody Auckland media? What did you think?
There was a little bit of that, I'd have to admit, John. Yes, here comes the Auckland media. We're being set up here big time.
As if. But then it is possibly true that there have been few protests in recent years. The big city folk have understood less.
It's like the kids have locked all the adults out of the cockpit. They're not listening to anyone.
They're going to starve if they don't back us.
Just back off.
Groundswell started as a movement to protest what farmers describe as unworkable government regulations. And then the protests kind of took on a life of their own with Trumpian MAGA references, Kiwi-fied.
Make up there and go away.
To fury at climate change protesters.
You dirty bitches, get off the bloody road.
So to understand them better, I went south to meet founders Bryce McKenzie and Laurie Patterson, and I think it's fair to say we were each a bit bewildered by the other. Laurie and Bryce, thanks for having me.
No worries.
I've never been to the South Island before.
Really?
did you almost believe me?
Bryce is a wee bit naive. You'll pick that up as you go through the thing.
Turns out it all began with a Facebook post letting off steam about the government's new freshwater policy and its impact on farmers.
I guess the number one thing for us, John, is we're concerned about the mental health of our people on the land because they are facing new regulations constantly, which they are not getting a say in.
I think one of the sobering things that we came across too, John, was after the first protest, the number of people that contacted us afterwards and said, look, just for one day, you know, I was proud to be a farmer. Yet these people feel ashamed of what they're doing. And it, you know, it doesn't matter what they do, they've sort of got this feeling. And when you have likes of the government that puts sort of unachievable goals out there.
Are they unachievable?
Some of them definitely were unachievable, yeah.
Are you climate change deniers? I mean, do you believe the climate is changing and it is our responsibility to do something about that?
Of course it's happening. We live in the climate every day. we're not sitting in an office somewhere with the heat pump on 18, working in our shirt sleeves. You know, we're actually out there in it. And so farmers know that the climate's changing. Of course they do.
So the protests were by farmers, for farmers, but as with protests anywhere, there wasn't unanimity, not even within the rural sector. Federated Farmers President Andrew Hoggard went so far as to call some of them crazy. Did you see that email from Andrew Hoggard to Damien O'Connor in which he described some of the Groundswell organisers as crazy?
Yes.
Was he talking about you, Bryce?
I hope not, John. I really do, because I actually have quite good dialogue with Andrew Hoggard.
So are some of you crazy?
It's really hard. When you set up something that's going to cover the whole of New Zealand and it happens really quickly, you get a bit stifled with your ability to actually be able to check people out.
I want to ask you about some of the images we saw from the Groundswell protests that, you know, people were offended by them. And I think there was reputational damage because of them. So, this one, a darn mad cow. Jacinda is a communist bitch. Black Utes matter. And this one, we live in New Zealand, not Aotearoa, stop ramming Māori language down our throat, which is just basically racist horseshit, right? What's that got to do with Groundswell and what you were saying to me?
Absolutely nothing at all, John. Absolutely nothing. I don't know how we could ever avoid it because it's a protest and people turn up. The very first protest Laurie and I did in Gore. Laurie was first, I was second. Guess who got in between us at a roundabout? A guy with a 1080 banner, which we've never ever had. So that's how easy it is for things to get taken away in the wrong direction. It just, it's about impossible.
So do you agree with that stuff?
No, we don't.
And the other thing is we put a, for the last protest, we put a code of conduct out there, how we expected people to behave, and we also put a list of approved signs out there. So those signs are coming from people that are not groundswell. Simple as that. We've got no time for racism and anything abusive.
We've really tried to not play the man in any situation.
Or the woman.
Or the woman. Sorry, completely. Yeah.
Do you think we understand each other? It seems to me that there is a townie way of seeing the world and a country way of seeing the world. But we know that there has been severe degradation in our waterways, and we know that we have CO2 emission issues, right? And we're not really talking to each other or listening to each other.
We need to do things. Nobody's saying we don't. We need to do it. But that needs to be done in a way that we're all working and understanding what's to come of it in the finish.
Needs to be common sense, that's the thing, rather than just arbitrary rules.
Who defines common sense? Isn't that why we're standing there having this conversation? My idea of common sense is probably really different from yours, isn't it?
Yes.
Doesn't self-interest enter the equation?
In some cases, it can't help but can it? Yeah, you're quite right. And how do you overcome that one? I'll ask you.
I'm buggered if I know.
Yeah.
I suppose consensus, right?
Yeah.
But for consensus, we've got to talk to each other.
Yes, exactly.
That's exactly right.
So we have to keep talking to each other, and we don't have to agree, that's the whole point, but we can disagree without hatred. Let's try an experiment. If you agreed with groundswell, my guess is you might not agree so much with our next guest, and vice versa. Our next guest is Hone Haruera, a veteran protester, although that phrase does him a disservice. This is a man who has effected real change in this country. Some of you will think he's fantastic, and some of you won't. That's the point, right? Let's go and meet him.
Tuesday morning, Lake Ngatu, a dune lake near Awanui and Waipapakaurī in the far, far north. Be here by 5:30, Hone Haruera texted me, and we were. By 6, we were out on the lake, as they are twice a week. It's tempting to see a symbolism in this, but that wasn't anyone's intention. Maintenance, one of them called it. They paddle to stay fit, to stay friends, to not worry about work and the beeping of phones. But they paddle best, of course, when they paddle in time. He waka eke noa. We are all in this together.
What is the most important thing, Hone Haruera, do you think?
Oh, for our whānau.
Whānau is a big word in a world that refused to even say it. This extraordinary footage is 49 years old. 1972, a petition being presented to Parliament to make Māori an official language. Incredibly, it wasn't until 1987 in the country it was from.
I want to talk about what you've achieved. So, this is going to air at TV1 on a Sunday night, right? And there will be some TV1 viewers who are looking at you and thinking, forgive my English, that bastard is a shit stirrer. Māori wasn't even an official language in this country. And you said, we need to be speaking our reo. You said, we need to acknowledge the loss of land and we need to provide some redress for it. So Māori became an official language, the Waitangi Tribunal, treaty settlements.
Bastion Point. Raglan, all of those land occupations which gave people a belief. And again, it goes back to that, challenging us to believe that nothing is too big, nothing is impossible. If we work together and we focus our attention, we can achieve many things.
I want to thank all of you here.
Of course, obviously, Hone Haruera didn't do all that alone, but he did it loudly, unrelentingly, and fearlessly. And he told other Māori again and again their voice deserved to be heard.
Our people are better than I am, but if I can bring them together in a way that we all act collectively, and you just watch them grow, some just amazing.
Border control is what has Honiharawera back in the news in an attempt to stop Aucklanders heading north from bringing COVID with them. Some are suggesting it's almost a kind of insurrection. In fact, these fluoro-vested crews will basically be asking the same as Air New Zealand is asking of its passengers.
Our aim isn't to turn everybody back and send them home. I mean, our whole aim is just to ask them whether they have their double vax, and if they have, come on through. And if they haven't, well, I'm hoping by the 15th, double vax or nothing. But double vax or a test is what the government's got at the moment. And we just need to know what that is. If they've got that, then come on through.
Come on through. And I did. Double vax, negative test. I was welcome. We sit out the back of his house, the grandkids' bikes listening in, that next generation getting ready to go. The flag that means so much to him fluttering on the ute. Nearby, the farmland is classic far north, and Awanui is minding its own business, as it always does. Not the centre of the world, but home to a man that's helped change it.
What difference can a person make, Honiharawera, if they set their mind to it?
Oh, Nelson Mandela, and he changed the whole world. Muhammad Ali. Huey P. Newton, my heroes. Sid Jackson, you know, my mum, my wife.
All of Honiharawera's heroes have stood for something, sometimes at huge cost. That's Horni at the back, by the way, steering us over the lake. If you believe in something, he says, launch your waka. If it's meaningful, people will join you. And if it's really meaningful, together you'll change the world.
The struggle for your rights is an ongoing thing. And if you find a role for yourself as the world changes, take it up. Don't be shy.
Hope for a generation. So we work in a whānau environment where we can support one another through every day.
In all of these things, with the bad, you also see the good. And I think that's the good thing about our country that I see. And that's what gives me hope. Hope for a generation.
wanted to end with hope, and to do that, we went to Matamata, Waikato, believe it or not. There we met Charlie, more than 40 years with St John. Imagine the drunken, violent Friday nights he's seen. But he still retains hope in us because of the other stuff he's seen us do. Something that has even more significance when you consider the year this story starts in. Forty years ago this year, we were really angry with each other. Pro-tour, anti-tour. 1981, when the Springboks came from apartheid South Africa, was a grim, divided year. On the second game of the tour, anti-tour protesters got onto the field in Hamilton, and the game against Waikato was called off.
As you can see, they've now stationed themselves on the pitch. We imagine there must be 500 or 600 of them.
I was standing at the end of the field where the protesters came through the fence.
Charlie Boulger was there with St John's ambulance, and somewhere in this chaos he was caring for people who'd been hurt, including a Red Squad police officer who'd been hit by a large flying cross.
I was down there ice packing his knee after he got hit, and he said, look, this is silly. He said, I'm against the tour, but he said, I've got a job to do like you have.
I've come to see Charlie at one of the country's most famous bowling clubs, not too far from Hamilton, 40 years on. And Charlie remembers how the 1981 divisions were so great, he wasn't sure we'd be able to navigate our way out of them.
I saw some very angry people. I worked in a stock and station firm at the time. I was a volunteer with St John at that stage.
But what Charlie also remembers in the afternoon sunshine of four decades later is that what binds us is tighter than we think. In the winter of 81, he saw families, colleagues, communities torn apart.
But if you went back a few months later, they're friends again.
There's something timeless about a bowling green, the way everything pauses for the bowl to slow and stop watching. In town, a few hundred metres away, the clock is ticking, the wheels are turning. But back here, the world seems a benign kind of place. The hanky's raised in admiration. Watch that bowl, watch it, kiss the jack. That idiot clapping is me, by the way. It's important not to be glib about the cost of enmity. Some wounds take a long time to heal, but Charlie thinks that most distances between us are closer than we think. We choose to hate, and we don't have to. So, Charlie, you've seen us at our worst sometimes. You've seen violence, you've seen rage, drunkenness, anger. You're on the field in 81 when the game was called off and we were so terribly divided. And yet I look at your eyes, and I look at your smile, and somehow it seems to me you remain really hopeful. How?
I think it's because in all of these things, with the bad, you also see the good. For everyone who is drunken and violent and so on, there's a whole lot more around them, I think, who are doing their best and carrying on with their lives and so on. And I think that's the good thing about our country that I see. And that's what gives me hope.
Go, Charlie. That was a lovely day in Matamata. Back here in Tamaki Makaurau, this, of course, is where the vast majority of our COVID-19 cases have been. And at the beginning of the year, Papatoetoe High School found itself at the centre of a cluster. Tough year to be a Year 13 student, but these are remarkable young people, and we went to meet four of them.
I'm Madison Wolfgram, and I'm Samoan and Tongan descent. I have a passion for dance, and I plan to be a graphic designer next year.
Kia ora, my name is Lurik Tao. My pronouns are she, they, and I want to work in film or be an anthropologist.
Kia ora, Andy Sambula Venaka. My name is Mozell, and after I leave high school, I'm going to get into trades and construction or fine art murals.
Hi there, my name is Cindy Nguyen, pronouns she, they, and next year I'm planning to study medicine, specialising in gynaecology.
How are you feeling, medicine? How are you feeling as school comes to an end?
It's definitely hard. Struggles, challenges. I mean, we didn't ask for this, we didn't ask for COVID, so this is all new to us, but we made it, so yeah.
You made it?
We made it.
You're clapping, Cindy. It's been a tough year, eh? Mm. You guys are 18. I presume you all turned 18 this year, right?
Mm-hmm.
So going Mozilla from being 17 to 18, they're kind of meant to be some of the best years of your life.
Yeah.
But we've been in a pandemic, you've been at home for weeks on end, we've been in lockdown. How are you feeling, Mozilla?
Going from 17 to 18, I was like, oh, there it is. It's 18, let's go out. And then, yeah, let's stay inside in your room.
So. Oh, yeah, because you're legal. You can go for and get a drink, right? But you were just in your bedroom.
In your bedroom doing work.
And how do you feel, I don't know who wants to pick up on this, but how do you feel about your future?
Before the pandemic, we were pretty sure, like, what we're going to do, what we're going to, like, head off into. But now, I guess, we're just all taking our time, just savoring the moment, as because we don't know what's going to happen, whether even if we're going to go to uni or not. Like,
so there's real uncertainty still.
Yes, definitely.
Do you feel trepidation about the world, the pandemic world, the angry world, the divided world?
I think the media is really good at blowing up this small minority to see them as such a threat and such a big group, when in actuality, when you look at how many people in the country are fully vaccinated or had their first dose, it's not as big as, still a problem nonetheless, but it's not as large as the media makes it out to be. Sorry, guys.
No, you're telling the truth there, aren't you?
Yeah.
What do you want from us? So the people at home who are watching this, and they're in, and there they are. What do you want to say to them about the world you're inheriting and how we could be better and kinder and more hopeful?
With the pandemic happening, no one's experienced this before, so it's a learning like step for everybody. The only thing that we can do is just learn off of our mistakes. I feel like the older generation, they were all brought up in a different type of era compared to us. You know, we all grew up in a different type of environment. So don't keep yourself too close-minded on the past and be more open to what comes in the future.
I'm not just saying this to be polite, but I think you are way better people than me and my friends were when we were 18. I think you're way kinder. I think you're way more empathetic. I think you're way more decent. And I hope you build a world that is a reflection of that.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Do you think you can?
We can hope.
We will try.
Definitely try.
Mm. We'll try, which is all you can ask of anyone, right? We must love one another or die, the poet Auden wrote, which doesn't mean we have to agree with each other. Imagine how boring that would be. But yelling at supermarket workers doesn't change the world, it diminishes it. We share this place, together, us.
It's been tough for everyone. But one thing that we need to do as New Zealand is get a bit of aroha.
Being kind to each other is probably the main thing.
Through manaakitanga, through being kind to one another.
We live in a multicultural society, so we need to respect each other.
Just don't be mean.
Coming to work and seeing the smile on my team's face is what gets me through the day.
Definitely family helps me get through this.
If I spend a time with my family, especially with my son, it makes me really, really happy.
We're all out there doing our own little bit to support others, keeping themselves safe.
We're out there supporting our community.
Majority of the time, we are definitely treated with respect.
One regular customer, he shops with us every week and he buys us a cake to share with our team in the team room.
Like, some people will run outside and give you chocolate just to say thank you.
So regardless what happens, we're still here for the wider community.
We do actually matter. We are people. And there is kind people out in the community that do care about us. I'm thankful for the love I share with my friends.